Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to the VIP Industries Limited Q2 and H1 FY 2022 earnings conference call. From the senior management we have with us today, Ms. Radhika Piramal, Executive Vice Chairman, Mr. Anindya Dutta, Managing Director, and Ms. Neetu Kashiramka, Chief Financial Officer. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Anindya Dutta, Managing Director, VIP Industries Limited. Thank you, and over to you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for taking time out this evening to join us on this call to discuss the VIP Q2 results. At the outset, we had fairly a good quarter two with a revenue of 337 crore, and more importantly, a very sharp recovery from the disruptions of the previous quarter due to the second wave. We saw a recovery of 80%, and this recovery is measured against our base of 2019-20 number. In fact, the quarter gone by has been our largest revenue quarter in the last seven quarters, including quarter four of 2019-20. We saw the business environment increasingly becoming better within the quarter and as the COVID cases came down sharply. Our key barometer of on to the airline passenger traffic data also saw a similar level of recovery. Airline passenger traffic saw a 60% recovery of the same compared to the same quarter 2019. However, international travel and schools, colleges predominantly remained closed and continued online, and we didn't have that demand. While the demand opened up, we faced two key challenges. One, we saw a sharp inflationary pressure building up in our raw materials, and this is also coming from the high ocean freight that we all know has scaled up at an abnormally high level. Also, we had constrained supplies coming from the disruption in Bangladesh that happened with a lag of almost 4-6 weeks after what we saw in India. The Bangladesh disruption continued way into August to the mid of the quarter. However, we had good and tight control on our fixed cost and all other offsets, and that resulted into an overall good result. Few highlights. You would have all received the presentation. Our quarter two revenue from operations was 337 crore and 421 crore in quarter one of this financial year. The gross margin was at 47% after netting off other income as compared to 51% in the sequential quarter. This has happened largely due to the inflation, as I spoke about, in the raw material cost and ocean freight, and also due to some unfavorable mix. EBITDA at 14%, 49 crore. This compares to 12% in sequential quarter and -16% over the same quarter last year. Overall profit for the period stands at 19 crore as against 3 crore of quarter one and a loss of 35 crore on the same quarter of the previous year. A little bit more details about our revenue construct. In terms of channels, we experienced good scale-up across all channels. E-commerce, with the tailwind of some of the organic shift that we have been experiencing that happened from other channels, was also back with the festive promotion. Over the last few quarters, our work on the fundamentals of the channel in terms of assortment, promotions, and performance marketing has given us dividends. Our traditionally stronghold channels, general trade and modern trade, also scaled up well within the quarter, and we witnessed our distribution in terms of number of doors have come back to 2019 levels. The retail channel, which is our exclusive business outlets, was continued to be challenged because this is where we had shut during the pandemic period a large number of our stores, and this channel will start scaling back as and when we open back the number of stores that we had shut. Also, the institutional business was suboptimal, largely coming from our supply constraint. Going forward, I believe the environment would be conducive for good demand, with hopefully COVID numbers continued to be reined basis the vaccination drive that has happened in the country, and the overall sentiments looks very positive. We are significantly increasing our investment in creating supplies for ourselves. We are expanding our Bangladesh manufacturing plant, and we have invested roughly about 15. We are planning to invest roughly about 15 to 20 crores in the coming time to expand capacities there, as well as we would be investing in our India supply chain here in our own manufacturing to increase capacities. Also, we would now start aggressively investing beyond creating demand and generating preference for our brand. And this not only will be seen in the promotions and advertising that we do, but also in the kind of new product that we are launching in the market today. The biggest challenge that will remain in front of us right now is to tackle the huge amount of inflation that we are foreseeing in the coming quarters. Overall, with the demand situation coming back, we are quite positive about the business going forward. Thank you, and I can now open the forum for questions.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star, then one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star, then two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star, then one. The first question is from the line of Karan Khanna from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. And my first question is on your, as far as the raw material inflation is concerned. Will it be possible to quantify now that almost 47% of your revenue is being manufactured at your hard luggage facility? Will it be possible to quantify the split between PP, PC and ABS at your Nashik manufacturing facility? And secondly, to counter these inflationary trends, what in the last 2 to 3 months?
Let me just jump in here. Radhika speaking. Thank you all for attending. Karan, I regret the first question is too detailed for us to be able to answer in this forum. And I request Anindo, please, to take the second question.
Yes, thanks, Radhika. So the price increases for the quarter gone by has been very little. The new products that we have launched has been priced in line with what we expect the raw material prices to be going up for. But on our base product range, we would be taking a price increase in the coming quarters.
Sure. Secondly, Neetu, in the last call, you mentioned that you were fairly positive that once the business returns to complete normalcy, the company can expect 20% kind of an aspirational EBITDA margin to sustain. You already had 80% in second quarter, and as you mentioned, you're quite confident on the recovery aspect as far as the next few months are concerned. In that context, is it possible to get some sense on what sort of a sustainable EBITDA margin should be the company's EBITDA margin in the next few months in the context of the inflation that we are seeing on the raw material side?
So mostly, Karan, we will be definitely taking care of the inflationary pressures. So there's a price increase which is lined up, which will happen in a month from now. So definitely our aspiration to reach what number we had talked about. But it all depends on the demand, context, and these raw material pressures.
Karan, if I may just add to that, because now based on our own manufacturing, which is more live a business, then importing and procuring well ahead, you know, ahead in time, the volatility of the raw material situation would have an effect on the overall margin and the results of the company. So the aspiration and ambition remains there, and we will do everything to get to that. However, we're right now not able to fully confidently comment on what kind of volatile raw material situation we would have, both on, in terms of price and also in terms of, you know, supply quantum. That also is under severe challenge right now.
Sure. I'll just add to that. I think when we said 20% EBITDA, we did not imagine the inflation would be so as sharp as it is. I mean, that's just a fact. I think it was not expected to be this much. So as Anindo correctly said, it remains the aspiration, but we are some way from it.
Sure. And on your balance sheet, I'm looking at the trade receivable. This has gone up from 148 odd crores to 256 crores as of 30th September. So any particular reason why there's a sharp increase on the receivables front?
That is mainly because of the scale. If you calculate number of day-wise, it has come down by 6 days.
Come down by 6 days, okay. And lastly, on the backpacks, will it be possible to understand if there's any recovery that you're seeing on that category, given what you're seeing as far as schools and colleges, gradually there is some sort of opening up that's happening on that side?
So, Garan, what we are seeing in the last couple of months is quite encouraging, because while fully schools and colleges has not opened up, there has been some sporadic in some states, some classes and some schools have opened. And the moment that has happened, we have started to see the throughput happening of this category. So as things become better going forward, I think it will just all fall in place going forward.
Sure. That will be my last question. I'll come back in. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prerna Jhunjhunwala from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Congratulations on a strong set of numbers. So, ma'am, I wanted to understand the capacity expansion plan because as mentioned earlier, our capacities were enough for pre-COVID level of sales. So the current capacity expansion that you are foreseeing, is it taking into account that we'll reach pre-COVID level of sales much sooner now, and it will be sustainable going forward?
If I was to understand your question better, are you talking about our capacities, our own manufacturing capacities in line with the pre-COVID numbers? And we weren't there, and that's the plan to build our own manufacturing up to the level of pre-COVID numbers. And that's something that's work in progress. The investments that we spoke about is all to increase our own manufacturing capacity. Having said that, we have enough avenues of sourcing, whether it is in India or the erstwhile supply of China, to bring in the supplies that is needed for the demand going forward.
And just to add to that, I think the question is also about demand forecast and how quickly is the demand coming back and how quickly will we reach pre-COVID. I think the demand resumption has been a bit happily faster than expected. So that's great news. So it's too early to say when will we cross pre-COVID numbers. But what we can say is after the terrible second wave, this demand resumption has been much faster than we expected. So suppose there's no variant, there's no third wave, which so far there has not been, then, you know, things are looking better than we expected on the demand side and much worse than we expected on the margin side.
That's great. And second, just wanted to understand on the demand side only, on the different type of product ranges, for example, in the mass segment as well as in the premium segment, how is the demand panning up? And how are you projecting your sales to how well you are prepared to take care of any divergence there?
So the demand thankfully is coming back into the mass premium and the premium segment. The large part of the demand increase happened in the previous quarters in the value segment. While that continues there, the demand on the mass premium and premium is also coming back, but the recovery rate in the higher in the premium segments is far lesser than the recovery that we are seeing or the growth that we are seeing in the value segment. That continues as a phenomena even now as we speak.
Okay. Okay. And my last question is on how are we looking at increasing our distribution network that you mentioned about in your remarks? Could you give some more color on that?
Sure. So we look at it from a channel point of view. The role of general trade is to build accessibility, and there we are. We would be going forward on a fast pace, increasing our distribution both in the towns that we cover and also go down pop strata into smaller towns to increase distribution. But that's a midterm to a long-term plan. Channels like exclusive business outlets, where we had shut down company-run stores and also a lot of franchisee stores shut down during the pandemic due to profitability issues. A lot of it is coming back, and in the next two quarters, we plan to aggressively try and take back our total number of retail stores or exclusive business outlets very close to the 2019 numbers. And definitely, in the subsequent year, we would aim to take it even far ahead of the 2019 numbers.
Okay. Okay. Any numbers that you would like to highlight on the distribution expansion, number of distributors, agents, dealers, etc.?
I can talk about retail stores. We had about 500 of them. We would be having, we shut down about 150, shut down inclusive of our own retail stores or franchisee stores. And we would try and get back to about a 460-odd number by the end of this year. That's one of the targets that the team has taken on.
Thank you. I'll come back to the question queue and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants to ask a question, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Bhargav M. from Kotak Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, team, and thank you for the opportunity. My first question is on the strategy of reopening the EBOs. So what we understand is that the EBOs which were shut down were not contributing significantly to the overall revenue, just about in single digits. So now that we are planning to again open EBOs back to 2019 levels, how should we look at this in terms of overall revenue contribution and alongside that, the profitable contribution as well?
Thank you for asking that question. You're right. From an EBO point of view, our strategy is to open through franchisee route. We are not encouraging our own investment and opening on our company run stores. So that's one. Majority part of the now opening will happen through a franchisee route, where we believe the retail operations to be run by a partner who's more suited to do it, and we continue to run the business of brands and creating demand. So that's did that answer your question?
Yeah, sure, understood. So I mean, in terms of the stores becoming profitable, what are we doing? I mean, because earlier the stores were sort of loss-making. So are we looking at different locations in terms of opening up, or how should we look at it?
Yeah, so from when the profitability question comes more for our company-run stores, and with COVID, we had shut down all the fundamentally loss-making store, and what we have now are again, on a fundamental basis, a profitable store. So all revenue increase would increase their profitability going forward. Also, the rent reductions and all that we did in a lot of places, we were able to bring down the cost for a longer run basis in terms of renegotiation of rents. That would also help to drive profitability of the company run stores going forward. In terms of the franchisee stores, it is selection of the right partners who has the best knowledge of the locale in which the store is coming up and is able to manage the cost, and therefore its profitability, and our profitability there is about the price that we sell to the franchisee. So there our profitability is kind of given, and we assist the franchisee to our best ability to make him profitable by investing in the revenue growth of that store.
My second question is, you mentioned that there was some supply chain disruption from Bangladesh. So was there any sales loss on account of this supply chain disruption? And if yes, what are we doing going forward to ensure that we don't have sales loss, given that the demand from the festive season could be much stronger?
Yeah, so to answer the first question, the disruption from Bangladesh supplies happened because of the second wave, which happened in Bangladesh in June, in July and August more. The peak was more in June, and it came down in July and August. So there was a lag of 4 to 6 weeks between our peak and Bangladesh peak, and therefore there was a national shutdown there, and the factories had disruption. So it kind of was a temporary disruption in quarter two, beginning part of the quarter two, which resulted in supply disruption downstream. We would have lost some opportunities of getting sale because of that disruption. Going forward, after that, from August, September onwards, the manufacturing is at full swing, and we don't see a disruption from Bangladesh causing, unless there is another wave or another event like that happens, we don't see a problem on a steady state coming in supplies.
And my last question is that, is it possible to quantify what could be the increase in revenues from this incremental capital investment which you are making both in India as well as in Bangladesh? Wanting to know the asset terms on this incremental investment.
No, I think that's too detailed for this conversation right now.
So, Bhargav, the basic purpose of increasing the capacities is to have our own dependence and not depend on an external party. So that's the whole point. Also, if suppose today we are doing an outsourcing, if we do in-house, we'll make more money. So that's how it will be. And if today I start to think about spending, it will take 3 to 6 months for the capacities to get built up. So we have to get ready for the next year. That's the whole plan.
Just one last question. Out of this total inventory of about 330 odd crores, the composition is broadly the same as in the first quarter, or the backpack inventory, school bags inventory has started coming off?
Yeah, backpack inventories have started coming off. Also, this also contributes more of raw material than FG fully, because we are getting ready for the next quarter.
Great, great. Thank you very much, and congrats for a very good performance.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Jinesh Joshi from Prabhudas Lilladher. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Madam, I mean, in the previous question, you highlighted that majority of the inventory on the balance sheet pertains to the raw material inventory. And with considering that we are facing RM cost inflation, is it fair to assume that our gross margins in the next quarter can be higher than 47%, which we reported in this quarter, because we have already sourced our RM inventory and the situation will be favorable for us?
See, most of the inventory is not RM. I said the mix is favorable towards RM. Also, whatever we have procured is at a high price only, because it already hit us, right? Inflation. Further increase, yes, there might be some gap, but our endeavor is to definitely have better margins, close to 50. But we'll have to wait and see how much price increase we can take, how the market behaves. Depending on that, the gross margin will depend. But yes, definitely we have an ambitious to really percent for the next two quarters.
Okay. And this 320 crores of inventory with a 50% gross margin can essentially support 600 crores kind of a top line. So essentially, our reliance on more sourcing for the next two quarters is lower, right? Is that the right way to think?
No.
So the 300 crore is not raw material inventory. That is finished good plus raw material. There is a certain proportion between them. So therefore, that does not translate into a 600 crore FG equivalent. And there is a raw material that needs to be procured for coming quarter and the quarter after that.
Okay. And one last question from my side. In the last call, we had stated that we plan to launch some 20 to 25 new products, and majorly one third of them would be from the value and the mass category. So how has been the response to the new launches? If you can just shed some light on that.
So one week, we have launched the set of products that we had planned to do in quarter two, and a lot of it is also planned in quarter three. All of them has been received extremely well in the market. And the strategy is paying up for us to generate demand basis that. So it's working for us.
Okay. And these launches, were they in the luggage segment or were they in the backpack segment?
This was predominantly in the luggage segment, because in the backpack segment, we are carrying some inventory from the past, as we spoke in the previous meetings. And, you know, once that inventory exhausts, we are going to come up with a completely new range in the subsequent, hopefully in the start of the next financial year.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ronak Vora from OHM Advisors. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Just a question on the cost side. How much would be our cost savings due to COVID, which, you know, wouldn't come back into our P&L?
So we had saved 180 crores in the COVID year, and 50% of this is sustainable, and 50% of this will come back when the business is back.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Niket Shah from Motilal Oswal Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on a decent set of numbers. I have two questions. So first is, given the fact that we have seen such a big amount of e-commerce ramp-up happening in the country, any thoughts of launching e-commerce specific or a D2C brand within luggage only for e-commerce? That's the first question. And the second question is, given Future was one of our largest customers and we had a very lumpy revenues there, with some clarity likely to emerge there, should one really assume normalization of those 250-300 crore bulky revenues coming back for us?
To answer your second question, we are also looking forward to that and share the same sentiment, because as things normalizes in one of our largest customers, we have no reason not to believe that we should be able to get back to the similar revenues that we had in the past.
And just one question. So we essentially lost about 300-350 crore of revenues. So we are the 85% of pre-COVID, assuming zero revenues from them, right? So in some sense, if that client would have been normalized, you would be above pre-COVID any which way.
So it is not. It has not become zero for sure. It has reduced higher than, or its recovery is lower than other channels. But all the stores are functional, and our business continues with them at a suboptimal level compared to what we think can happen in those stores and in with the banner.
Sure. On the internet specific brand?
Oh yes, on your e-commerce question. So well, that could be a strategy that we could look at, an exclusive brand, but mostly I think the codes of e-commerce is to really look at the consumer demand profile and to create our offerings in line with that. We're doing well there, and we continue to invest behind the demand that is coming up in e-commerce through our current brands and mostly through the portfolio that we are building under the current brands. So the same brand architecture is taken forward in e-commerce, and we are mostly thrusting on the right mix that we need to develop for e-commerce there.
Got it. And has there been any case in this quarter or what you're seeing right now where you're running short of inventory for certain SKUs, where demand is far higher than supply? Are you seeing those kind of situations happening currently?
Yes, I spoke about that in the quarter that has gone by. We have faced several supply situations, and the cause of that was Bangladesh disruption, as I spoke about it. While there is no common thread across, you know, any specific SKU or a range, but you know, the production that happens in Bangladesh, that range had issues in the previous quarter in terms of supplies. But that's got corrected now for the coming quarters.
Got it. And one final question, if I may squeeze in on exports, if you can just let us know any progress on that side, or is it continues to remain in slightly slower lane?
So the export business continues, but there is no major thrust that we are doing in that side right now, largely coming from our supply side, and the idea would be to first fulfill the demand that is there in India and in the near future in the domestic business before we start looking outside.
And for Caprese, we plan to launch the Caprese into other channels and much more wider rollout. Any update on that?
So in Caprese, is the focus on e-commerce is the highest right now from Caprese channel point of view, Caprese brand point of view. But yes, we do play it in other channels as well. In the near future, we would like to go deeper into the e-commerce business with Caprese before we take it across many channels.
Perfect. Thank you so much, and I'll come back. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Gautam Bafna from Wisdom Torch. Please go ahead.
Hi, everyone. I believe demand is stronger in hard luggage segment in our case. So, how much capacity do we have in hard luggage in-house, and what is the current capacity utilization level over there?
So you're right, the demand is in favor of hard luggage, and that's a welcome thing for us because that's been our stronghold in the past. We are, as I spoke about in Bangladesh, we intend to initiate hard luggage manufacturing as well in the near future. So today in Bangladesh, in the past, we were doing largely soft luggage in Bangladesh, but in the future, we are investing to create both, molding as well as assembly of hard luggage in Bangladesh. So that's where we will expand. We are also looking at avenues of expanding hard luggage manufacturing within our Nasik facility to further create headroom in hard luggage.
So my question was regarding the existing capacity and capacity utilization level. You can throw some light on that.
So existing capacity is 100% utilized right now.
Sure. And during COVID wave, the unorganized sector was hardly impacted. So do we see any recovery in that segment?
Recovery
from do we see unorganized players recovering back and given this competition, or they are still hardly impacted?
Difficult to say right now. I think the unorganized sector would not go away completely, but there would be, I'm expecting the unorganized sector to have more challenge than the organized sector in the coming few quarters, coming largely from supplies and the import situation from China. So to that extent, they would have higher headwinds than the organized sector, and that could be favorable for players like us.
Sure. And my last question regarding raw material, are we making any shift, from polycarbonate to polypropylene to improve on our costing part?
Yes, we did that as part of our hard luggage strategy, and that's the reason why the investments we are talking about in Bangladesh as well as possibly in Nasik would have a higher share of polypropylene than polycarbonate.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Pulkit Singhal from Dalmus Capital Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question, and congrats on a good set of numbers. Just trying to understand the Bangladesh related sourcing in 2Q. What percentage of sales is coming from Bangladesh in the second quarter?
For quarter two. This would keep changing basis inventory levels, but roughly about 40% of the revenue came from what was manufactured in Bangladesh.
Sure. And the decision to also manufacture hard luggage in Bangladesh, I'm just trying to understand the benefit vis-a-vis India. Because I understand in soft luggage, at least there's a lot more labor cost to be involved. But how does it help in the hard luggage side?
The eastern part of the market could have a easier access from there from a freight point of view. And anyway, if you need to augment capacity, it helps to put up in consolidated areas. There could be some advantage in the raw material, which is what we are assessing in terms of being in a SEZ location in Bangladesh.
Okay. But broadly, Bangladesh versus India, it's 10 to 15% cheaper in terms of sourcing?
About 10%, yes.
Okay. And can you quantify the lost sales in 2Q because of the supply issue?
No, very difficult to quantify that right now.
Got it. Lastly, if you can talk about the CapEx plans, I mean, this year and how you look at it for the next 3 years.
I won't be able to talk about next 3 years in this discussion today, but in the immediate future, we are looking about, let's say, about a 20 crore in Bangladesh. And we are just about building the plans for India capacity expansion.
Got it. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Madhuchanda De from MC Research. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I just have one small question. As you mentioned that the one of the intention of the ramping up of the capacity is to have more reliance on own manufacturing. So if you look back to FY20, which was the last normal year, suppose if you had sourced everything from your in-house, what kind of a difference would it have made to your margin?
Yeah.
4%,
3-4%. At least that much. We can't give you a precise number, but I think it will be anywhere between 3-5% range.
3-5% and in the at the EBITDA level.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks a lot and all the best.
Thank you.
Participants, to ask a question, please press star, then one. Anyone who wishes to ask questions, please press star, then one. The next question is from the line of Neeraj from GL Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so thank you for taking my question. With respect to supply chain on the raw material side, are there any challenges we are facing? Because, again, there we are completely dependent on China, especially on the soft luggage side.
Yeah, so you're right. We apprehend significant challenges going forward. It wasn't a challenged environment in the past, but China, with the rationing of electricity and the overall government giving less priority on lower value added products, we are apprehending possible disruptions. So therefore, what we are doing right now is to try and get one raw materials ahead of its time in terms of securing the supply. Also, we are initiating the lookout for alternate vendors in India, in Bangladesh, and in elsewhere in the world. So that work is on fast pace, happening to develop alternate sources for raw materials and components.
So any kind of timeline you can provide where we would be 100% independent of China in raw material sourcing? And away from China, that's one. And second is, if it is from India, then exporting back to Bangladesh and bringing back again, will it justify the value addition norms when the two countries have for FTA?
Yeah, First, to answer the first question, no, we can't have an exact this thing on the difference it will make. In terms of alternate sources, that's something that is work in progress to look at various possibilities. India sourcing is also for whatever we make in India, both in our plants as well as in the outsourced, contracted manufacturing. And Bangladesh could look at options from countries like, Vietnam, Cambodia, also in local Bangladesh supplies. But this is too nascent a work right now. So at this stage, commenting more than this is not going to be possible from our side.
So second is on the gross margin side and then down to EBITDA level. The raw material cost push is for everyone. It's across everybody on the earth. And I'm sure even similar, as you explained earlier, it is more hurting the unorganized sector. So is it going to be difficult? Because we are seeing in consumer goods and other consumer products where corporates are taking price increases from 4 to 12% and actually passing on entire cost push to the consumer. And in fact, we are seeing that consumer is somehow accepting it. So will that be challenging or a bit difficult in our case of product? Yeah, I do understand that we are just opening up in terms of demand. But for past 2 years, we have seen consumer hasn't bought our products. So will it still be very difficult to pass on, or what's your thought on that?
So it's not the best place to be in when you need to take price increase, but the raw material inflation will need to largely get passed on to the consumer in the given environment that we are in. So we will have to do it. It's not the best thing to do, but it won't be difficult to do that in the current demand supply environment, and therefore we may need to take the kind of price increases you're talking about even in this category. But we are yet to fully get a sense of what kind of inflation will happen in the coming two quarters, which can only give us the quantum of price increase that we need to take.
So you are talking more about the volatility which is happening, right?
Yeah.
Sir, on the hard luggage side, can you quantify what percentage of revenue was in Q2?
47%.
Hard luggage, 47% overall.
Yeah. Thanks a lot and wish you all the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pritesh Chheda from Lucky Investments. Please go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to understand what is the mix on outsourcing and in-house manufacturing within that Bangladesh and India, and because I think both the places we have our own manufacturing. And how is this mix going to change over the next 2-3 years based on the investments that we have proposed of that?
So the mix used to be about 40-60 in the past, 40 in favor of our own manufacturing and 60 from buying of finished goods from outsourced manufacturing. Our aim is to take it to about 60-40 at the first level from purely own manufacturing to outsource, and that's the direction on which you're working on.
And let's say within this 40 or 60, whichever you want to refer to in-house, how much would Bangladesh contribute in this?
So Bangladesh would be about 35 to 40%, and the balance of that 60, what it would be Nasik or India manufacturing.
Of the 60, okay. And I'm just confirming, Bangladesh is 100% subsidy for us, right? There's no JV partner there, right?
No, it's 100% subsidy.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Akhil Parekh from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Just one clarification. In the previous remarks, you mentioned that we almost shut 150 odd stores during the pandemic. and we plan to bring that back live by end of this year, and that will be 416. That will be mainly through the franchise route. Is that correct?
That's right.
Okay. So would that change our product mix if we are opening more stores through the franchise route versus the company owned or operated? Because in other product categories, we usually see that the product mix is on a more focus on the value products. If the store is a franchisee-driven store as against the FOCO stores, would that be the case in VIP as well, or it won't?
No, so franchisee product portfolio or the mix to be different from company-run store is not, it's not a fact. I think the product mix would remain same. Because finally, it is all depends on who is running the store, not, you know, what the store is to the consumer. So the mix will be similar to a company-run store. It's just the modus operandi will be different. We will not be running those stores ourselves.
Okay. Okay. And of the 350 stores which are open right now, how much would be FOCO stores and how much would be franchise at this point of the time?
So it's about 100 and 250. 100 for company run, about, I'm giving you a rough split, about 250 is franchisee run.
Sure. Okay. And the second question is the RM part, the inventory part. We have around 300 crore of inventory, and we mentioned that, you know, a significant portion would be on the raw material side. And we are seeing that the polymer prices are still on an inclining trend. Would that be a fair assumption that we might book inventory gains in coming quarters if the price trend continues to be higher?
Let me first clarify, out of the 300 crores, while we are not giving an exact split, but the raw material part is not the majority part. It has a raw material component also into it, along with FG was the comment in the past. So we would not have a material, you know, raw material arbitrage here in terms of having bought it early. So to that extent, polycarbonate and polypropylene that we use in India is mostly bought with a very minimum inventory in hand. So it's a spot that we buy.
Sure, got it. Thanks for clarification and best wishes for coming quarters.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Karan Khanna from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, thanks. I had a follow-up question. So, Anandya, you mentioned that, you know, to one of the previous participants, you mentioned that 3-4 years out, you're looking at 20% revenue contribution from Nasik and 40% from Bangladesh. But if you look at this quarter, hard luggage, which is almost operating at 100% utilization, that's 155 crores contribution to your September quarter revenue. So, in that context, is it fair to assume that with Bangladesh peak revenue at, Nasik peak revenue at 600 odd crores, when you're keeping in mind the 60-40 split between own manufacturing and outsourced, so 3-4 years out, you're looking at something like a 2,800 to 3,000 crores sort of a revenue potential. Is that what you're internally projecting?
Karan, you've done a lot of mathematics and I'm not able to follow you on that. But somewhere you commented on the Nasik and therefore the hard luggage manufacturing. So I must tell you that we do hard luggage currently also in Bangladesh, which is more an assembly line. So the total hard luggage that we are seeing as a component of our total sale has both a Nasik and a Bangladesh component to it, where Bangladesh is also going to go up in hard luggage and Nasik also go up in hard luggage. Like we are going up in soft luggage in Bangladesh as well as in India sourcing. So, you know, these are the three sources that we are going to rely on. We have our own manufacturing in Bangladesh, our own manufacturing in Nasik, and we would have exclusive manufacturing partners in India. This together should, over a period of maybe a couple of years, should become about 80-85% of our total manufacturing. And therefore, that gives us a good control upstream and therefore a better control on our costs.
Sure. Great. Thank you and all the best. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in this conference call, please limit your questions to two per participant. For any further questions, you may come back for a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Aditya Lalpuria from B&K Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. I just wanted to ask, what is the brand strategy which the company is following? Like, which brand is the company focusing on, and which brand is the company like looking to push in order from high to low?
So we have a very robust brand architecture, and that's been a big asset that has worked for us in the past. Brands in VIP, as VIP, Skybag, Aristocrat, and Caprizi. We plan to take these four power brands forward in the architecture that we have. So this doesn't evidently needs to have any kind of a change in that. Each brand has its four particular positioning within the product categories that they are in, and it is all about, you know, taking those brands and its equity to the next level as we go forward.
Okay. And so, like, one more question, like, how is the demand panning out in the current festive season, like, if you can give a color on that?
So, as I said, demand is looking good. It looked good towards the later part of the previous quarter, and it continues to be on the high as we speak in the festive season. So, from a demand side, nothing much to complain. Except that as international travel opens and schools and college opens, I think the premium end of the luggage segment as well as backpack demand, we are awaiting to open up.
Okay, sir. So this was helpful, sir. And just one last question, if I may squeeze in, sir. So, like, what is the status of the insurance claim?
So currently the insurance file has moved to the HO. The amount is large. It has to go up to the board. So we are expecting some positive in next 2 to 3 months.
Okay, ma'am. Thanks a lot. That's it from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jayveer Shikawat from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Right. Thanks for taking my question. So, Mr. Dutta, my question is in relation to, say, the upcoming festive season. Which of the micro markets do you expect to benefit the most? And Ms. Neetu, if you can just help us understand how it has been historically as well.
So we don't have a point of view on any specific market, micro market in the festive season. The good part is that it kind of activates across the country, and in the way we are constructed from our channels and our geography point of view, we experience a demand upliftment in across all sectors going forward.
Sure.
There's only a change. So in the past, if you see the wedding season, that is something which is, you know, area specific. Or for example, Bihar UP is a large market where,
yeah,
so the wedding season, when it comes, that
right.
A large part of the business happens in that area.
Right. And second, in terms of the Chinese supply chain disruptions and the kind of strained relationships that most of the players have been facing with these dealers, can you help me understand what is going on over there, especially, say, in terms of the credit period crunch or in terms of them not taking bulk orders?
So one is the finished goods kind of procurement from Bangladesh, and the other is the raw material. The ties with our vendors and raw material and all that has been good and continues to be good. In China, they are facing an issue of power shortage, and therefore their ability to manufacture the demand that we are putting in front of them in raw material could be a challenge, and that is a possible disruption that we are preparing against.
Sure. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankit Kanodia from Smart Sync Services. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. My question was related to when the pandemic hit. My sense is that the unorganized sector was hit even more than the organized sector. Now, when assuming that we are coming out of the pandemic now, how do you see this situation? And the second question is related to how do we see our product mix and discounts during this festive season? because we have noticed that one of our competitors have been running really huge discounts, and their products are available at really, really cheap price points in the modern trade segment particularly. Any color on that as per what our strategy is?
So to answer your first question, and I think it was asked by someone in the previous questions as well. So organized sector, we need to, unorganized sector, we are yet to see what kind of, you know, situation they, you know, the whole sector evolves into post-pandemic. Yes, there would be disruptions as it was for the organized sectors like us. It will be, there have been disruptions in the unorganized sector also. And I, as I said, I expect the tailwind on the organized sector to be higher because of ability to come out of disruptions, possibly better. So that's on the unorganized, organized and versus organized sector. In terms of discounts, given the inflationary pressures that the whole industry is aware of, we have pulled back in terms of the you know, super aggressive discounting to generate demand going forward. We are possibly putting a more attention behind building our brands and building consumer franchise through routes which are not just discounts. While we continue to do relevant promotions, but our approach is to bring more value to consumers and not just reduce price. So that's going to be our approach going forward.
Yeah, thanks. That helped. And just a follow-up to that. So when the pandemic hit, we saw that over the last, say, 1 year or so, the value segment getting more demand compared to the premium segment or the mass segment, I should say, rather than the value segment. So are we seeing any improvement in terms of the premium segment getting more demand now once we are getting out of the pandemic, or we are still some distance away?
No, I would say we are seeing green shoots there, and I think the premium segment also depends upon a certain you know, economic strata really starting to spend time in leisure, in vacation and in weddings, and as international travel opens, I think those were the codes on which the premium segment operates on, and that's possibly not opened up as much as the performance travel or a functional travel was there in terms of a consumer behavior. So I think it is going to come back to where it was, while the value segment would possibly going forward on a long-term basis will have a higher you know, share of the overall industry or category, but that will not going to be stopping the demand that should happen in the mid premium and the premium segment.
Okay, and if I may ask one more question, what category you are seeing in terms of is getting more strength in terms of demand, e-commerce or modern trade or other any other category?
Like, so e-commerce has been the flag bearer of you know, increase in demand during the pandemic time, and as I said, it's also due to a lot of disruption in the physical channel that has happened during the pandemic. But equally, we are also observing that as market starts to open up, as people start to travel freely, go around, the traditional channels like retail or modern trade is you know, month on month progressively becoming better. Having said that, there would be the post-pandemic situation in the coming years will definitely have a far higher share of e-commerce now, because that's almost a permanent change in consumer buying behavior that has happened. So in the pandemic has helped the shift towards e-commerce, and today it is could be far higher because other channels have been comparatively lower. But going forward, other channels will also come up, but e-commerce will stabilize at a far higher salience to our total channel sales than what it was before COVID.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to Ms. Neetu Kashiramka from VIP Industries Limited for closing comments.
Thanks everyone for joining the call. I hope we have been able to answer to all your questions. In case anybody has any further questions, please feel free to call. And happy Diwali to everyone. Thank you.
Happy Diwali to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of VIP Industries Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect.